Hello and good afternoon to everyone. Is it a bad deal? Is the Iran deal is a historic mistake, as Prime Minister Netanyahu had said, or is it the only credible path to prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon, from acquiring nuclear weapon, as President Obama and also Wendy Sherman here a few minutes ago was arguing? This is yesterday's debate, and maybe the debate for the next decade, the historic debate. We will try to deal here with the time in between those two debates of what will happen in the day after, which is today. And giving the deal and the lifting of the sanction and the fact that Iran has the legitimacy and also the money that is coming, and giving the fact that they took out their stockpile of uranium and blocked their plutonium path, what should we do, Israel and United States and the rest of the world? And given the fact that Iran is still playing in other fields in the region, above all, we need to ask ourselves, how can we make sure that Iran will not turn into a bigger threat in the region than it already is? So I have here all these specialists here with me, and I would like to present to you the Honorable Jane Ehrman. She resigned from Congress 4 years ago to join the Woodrow Wilson Center as the first female director, president, and CEO. This is the time that you clap. During her 9 terms in Congress, she serves on all the major security committees, and she's well known here in Israel. Nice to have you here. We have here François Heisenberg. He's the chairman of the Council of the Geneva Center for Security Policy and the London-based International Institute for Strategic Studies. Nice having you here with us. Sir John Jenkins. I serve as the president as the UK ambassador to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and has previously been the UK ambassador to Iraq, to Syria, and to Libya. He has also served in Abu Dhabi, Kuwait, and Consul General in Jerusalem, and so many fun places that you've been in the region. Very calm. He also held BA and doctorate from the Cambridge University. We have here near Jane Herman, Yaakov Amidror, which is the former National Security Advisor to the Prime Minister of Israel and the head of National Security Council. He served 36 years in a senior IDF post, including Commander of the Military Colleges, Military Secretary to the Ministry of Defense, and Director of the Intelligence Analysis Division in Military Intelligence, and Chief Intelligence Officer in the Northern Command. And we have here also new to me, Avner Golob, is a PhD candidate at Henry Truman Scholar of the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy in Tartu University, and is a Richards Fellow of the Israel Institute for National Security Studies, this one, the INSS. I'm very glad to have you all both. And I'll start with you, Mr. Amidror, if I may. Can we sum it up? Obama won, Netanyahu lost. What we do now?
good evening. First of all, I don't see Wendy Sherman. Wendy, nothing personal.
It's always personal. And Yaakov, if you can speak to the microphone.
I don't want to begin now to deal with the details of the agreement, which I think is not as good as was described by Wendy. And I want to speak about the future, with your permission. There are three elements that we have to take into consideration. By the way, you forgot to say that I'm now member of Bessa Center in Bar-Ilan University, and hosting here by my good friend Amos Yadlin in the INSS. There are three areas that we have to deal with. One is the American side of the agreement, that for us, for the Israelis, is very important. At the end of the day, in a very short sentence, we learn through the process that there are some areas in which our interests and the interests of the United States are not the same. And we might face this situation in the future, and because of that, we cannot trust that all the options that everyone is speaking about, and no one believes that they are really there, will be taken by the Americans when will be a need, if will be a need. I'm not sure that it will be. The second one is the Iranian side of the agreement. The Iranian came out with the agreement, and now I'm quoting some Iranians, scholars. They understood that they now have it was agreed by the Americans through the agreement that Iran is a superpower in the Middle East, and they intend to behave and to act as a superpower. And we will see the Iranians all around the Middle East behaving like a superpower with all the consequences for Israel. And the Americans will not be there to limit the Iranians when they will act. The third is the Middle East issue. The Arab countries around us understood, as we understood, that the Americans took side with the Iranians against the Sunni world. And they are afraid from these consequences. And what you see in Saudi today is the result of their understanding. And for Israel, it might be an opportunity, but there are prices to buy this opportunity and to implement it.
I want to focus my question for a second. Do you think that the day after the agreement has been made, that Israel didn't have any influence on that agreement, do you think that this is time to negotiate with the American about a new strategy in the Middle East, considering all the factors that you just mentioned?
Mistake number one, we had a lot of influence on the agreement. Second, we didn't agree with the Americans about the strategy. They decided, instead of dismantling, to go to postponing and monitoring. That was not agreed. They went their way, and we don't believe that this is the right one. And the whole process of coordination, dialogues, and so forth, continue through the whole process about Iran and other issues. This is not a problem regarding the agreement. The agreement is not a problem that we don't have channels to speak with the Americans and to exchange views and so forth. This is not the problem. The problem is the agreement that Americans changed the policy and instead of dismantling the Iranians, decided to postpone and to monitor. About that, we don't agree. We don't intend to agree in the future. And now it is a fact. It's like the weather. We cannot change it. And what should be done and is done today, I mean every day, is dialogue about what should be the next stages in the Middle East, relating to Iran and other issues.
All right. Ms. Herman, I just want to ask you, we heard Wendy Sherman presentation, and we heard Jacob Amidrow, which is very polite, but he's saying, you're mistaken. And I want to ask you something else. This is not only about Netanyahu and Obama, which of course are BFF, best foes forever. But it's in all the other representatives of Israeli politics here, even in the opposition, there was not even one of them that came out in this stage and said, I salute the Obama administration for a great deal that make the Middle East a safer place. How can you explain that?
First, let me say something about my friend of a quarter century, Wendy Sherman. I hope all of you heard in her voice both the confidence that she did the right thing, but the pain of the difficulty negotiating with friends here. I certainly heard it. It almost made me cry. And I say to you, Wendy, that I hope everybody here appreciates how much effort you personally made and how much effort the United States made to reach for people in Israel who, whether they agreed or not, are our dearest friends. I say that on behalf of me,
and do you think
a long-term member of Congress who made every effort in the roles that I served. Now,
perspective, Netanyahu and Amidrar made a mistake of going into confrontation with the American administration?
Well,
on that?
I think mistakes were possibly made on both sides in the relationship. It's not exactly the closest relationship between the two leaders, but it is a respectful and a working relationship. And I think that the next president, whoever she may be, hopefully we'll have a personally warmer relationship. Yeah, but here's
past,
my point.
In the past, they have such a wonderful relationship, the she and the he.
Well, no comment.
All right.
Let me talk about the politics, though. Remember the tough politics in the United States. This is still is not a popular agreement in the United States. The United States Congress had probably more people against it than for it. Let's understand that. Congress never voted on the deal and never voted to disapprove the deal because of the legislation that was agreed to sometime before the deal was made. But there are many in Congress in both parties who are enormously skeptical. And I mention that because that's an insurance policy. Congress is watching closely. And the deal was transactional, not transformational, as my Wilson Center colleague Rob Litvak has written. And it does free up some brain cells now to focus on Iran's other bad behavior. And that is the most concerning, it seems to me, in the short term to this region and to the United States. And I think the new sanctions on the ballistic missile test and the continued sanctions on Iran's use of proxy groups matter. And I think Israel plus the skeptics in Congress will make sure that Iran's other behavior is focused on.
Thank you very much. So John Jenkins is someone that was traveling here in the fun places that I just mentioned in Saudi Arabia and the other Sunni cities. Do you agree with Mr. Amit Dror that the Sunni states are feeling betrayed by American strategy towards Iran?
Thank you very much. first of all, the deal is a deal. It's done. And sometimes I get very bored of talking about the deal itself because it's a fact. So the issue is enforcement of the deal. Now, for the Saudis and others, there's a paradox here because 4 or 5 years ago, the Saudis were saying, if you negotiate with the Iranians, you need to put other things on the table as well. You can't put other things on the table because putting other things on the table, the Iranians are exploited. Now they say, of course, the problem with this is not that it's a nuclear deal, but that it's simply a nuclear deal. They themselves have factored in, I think, the fact of Iran as a potential nuclear power. They say this themselves. The issue is everything else that Iran does in the region. I don't think Iran has become a superpower overnight in the region any more than I think Saudi Arabia has become a superpower in the region. The issue is the balance. And the issue with the balance in the Middle East is that there is no natural balance of power in the Middle East, which is why we've always gone for collective security, administered by an outside security guarantor, which since the early 1970s, since we withdrew from Eastern Suez, has been the United States. So when I think about the next 15 years, it's about reconstructing some sort of collective security and some sort of containment of Iran. I always thought this deal in the end would culminate in some sort of containment strategy. I don't think we've got that at the moment. I think the sanctions which have been introduced on the 11 companies and individuals because of the ballistic missile tests and so forth are good, but they're relatively mild. There's a whole set of other things about the Iranian complicity in the militification of Iraq, the militification of Syria, the long-term militification of Hezbollah, and their attempted militification of Yemen, for example, which needs to be addressed. The Saudis and others need to be drawn into this new system. Now, there's been a lot of talk, if you read there's papers written over the years, which say that the new security dispensation in the Gulf needs to include Iran. I personally don't see how that works. It was tried in the 1970s. We had the dual policeman policy on Saudi Arabia. It didn't really work because the Shah was all over the place. And
do
it
you
won't
think
work
that
now.
The feeling, that feeling of betrayal by sure. the United States and others can be used as the new coalition
they
or
feel
to combine what Amit Dror said to what we heard yesterday from the chief of staff here, Gadi Eisenkot, that said that this deal has many risks, but many opportunities. Let's focus about the opportunities. What do you think they are?
Well, first of all, I think the Saudis in particular do feel abandoned. I think if I'm sitting in Dubai, I see there's massive opportunities because you'll probably get, between, I don't know, $15 and $20 billion worth of new trade every year, maybe more coming through. So there are massive trade opportunities in the Gulf. And if you talk to Gulf states, they will say this. We recognize Iran is 80 million people. It's a huge market, diverse. It could be part of a new economic dispensation in the wider Middle East, Central Asia, and the rest of it. But we don't think it's going to happen because we think, essentially, this is a state, not the society, the state, which is dedicated to its own survival. And as part of that strategy, it expands its often covert hegemony throughout the region, and that's what we need to roll back. A normalized Iran, as we think we saw when Rafsanjani and Khatami were presidents, would be fine. Mm-hmm. But you need to do something about the security apparatus inside Iran.
All right, thank you. Following up on that, Mr. Francois Heisenberg, has been said here, the deal is a deal, even though you can say that in the Middle East there is never a done deal. But let's speak about the moral essence or the practical consequence of that deal. Iran froze its nuclear plan, but they got a lot of power in the Middle East. That's what Yaakov Amidror spoke of. Do you think they got the feeling that the West, France, and the P5+1, and mainly the President Obama, is in no mood for confrontation? They felt that they can get the money, they can get the facilities, and they can go in other fields to get their goal achieved without the nuclear bomb.
The deal is a nuclear deal. Its consequences have to be judged according to the merits of the deal. Is the world safer in nuclear terms as a result of the deal? I think the answer is a straightforward yes. Is the Middle East safer overall as a result of the deal? The answer is possibly not. And let me expand on that a little bit. And I'll begin with a paradox. Iran is not a nuclear power.
Yet.
And it will presumably not be one for a long time. Which means that if Iran gets very muscular in its relations with others, if it expands its military and political activity in Iraq, in Syria, in Lebanon, in Yemen, if its hegemonic aspirations in the Gulf develop notably through its economic influence along the lines hinted at by John, whatever will result will not be a nuclear crisis. It will not become, by definition, a global crisis. If a nuclear power starts acting in an extremely obstreperous way, you have a global problem. And it goes straight to the Security Council. It deals with it well or it doesn't, but it doesn't stay regional. In the case of Iran, they are in effect unfettered by the fact that they are not a nuclear power.
But you know, now they got the legitimacy, and I want to ask you, if you look at what happened in Iran and in the region, from the moment the deal was been done and been implemented, their aggression has grown. What do you learn from that?
And that was indeed my third point. Iran is well poised to act in the way that I suggested. That is, it has a state. It has a fair degree of functional competence, something you do not find in most areas of the Gulf, and notably not in Saudi Arabia. Competence is not a word you would associate, for example, to the Saudi campaign in Yemen. They have a great deal of trouble even patrolling their own border with Yemen, despite the fact that they're bombing the place every day. Iran has the ability to diversify its economy in a way which Saudi Arabia does not. In a world of lower oil prices, in a world where competence actually does count, Iran may very well develop its power further. And the fact that it is not a nuclear power actually makes that easier. That is the basic paradox of this whole affair. Now, of course, if Israel really prefers to have a nuclear Iran, which does not develop its power in the same way, except that it will have the ability to destroy Israel. I'm not sure that is a trade-off that would be very agreeable. I think the unsafety which results from Iran becoming a non-nuclear hegemon in the region is probably less ominous, less existential than the danger which would result from Iran and other countries in the region going nuclear.
So I want to turn to our fifth panelist, Mr. Avner Goloban, to quote you what President Obama said. He said, once the agreement expires, Iran will be placed in almost zero breakout distance from a bomb. So what is the best strategy when Iran is not a nuclear power now, and yet is not a nuclear power? What is the best strategy for Israel and for the United States to prevent Iran to breaking out towards a nuclear weapon in 10 to 15 years?
Okay, thank you so much for inviting me. I would like to start with a disclosure, if I may. So General Amidror was my boss, and I learned for many years that it's a good lesson for all of us. Don't be yes man. If your boss says no, you should also say no, okay?
Well, it's easy with that government.
Exactly. Now, I think the best strategy, and sometimes when we read the newspaper here in Israel or even in America, when I live right now, it seems like we have one round game, whether we lose or win, but it's a one round game. And this is not the case. It's a multi-round game. And we need always to prepare for the next game and to learn from the last game. And in the next game, I would like to see America and Israel that work together and not fight against each other. And the way to do it, and this is a key for the strategy, and this is an idea we developed here at INSS, is a side agreement, a parallel agreement between America and Israel, which includes both the nuclear and non-nuclear Iranian misbehavior. And I'm really concerned about the fact that we can separate here in the panel between the nuclear behavior and the non-nuclear one. We need to reconnect it and to find one strategy that encompasses all of these Iranian challenges.
Ms. General, I want to ask you something about something that have happened previously, but it's also maybe a lesson for the next stage, as Avner said. Do you think that the administration was so worried that Israel will do something on the Iranian case, like an attack, that it allowed the NSA to keep on tracking Prime Minister Netanyahu calls that was published?
I don't know, is my answer. And I surely hope not. Israel is our close ally, including the Prime Minister. That would be my comment on that.
So you know for a fact that there was no espionage about Netanyahu?
On this issue of realigning the two, the nuclear and the other bad behavior, let me move along here. I think that's an interesting idea, but I think the bad behavior, other than nuclear, needs to be the priority. I think it is what Iran is engaged in. I do agree with the comment that they have ratcheted it up, but an observation I would make is that politics inside Iran is not a monolith. Let's remember that the Iranian guards and the Rouhani crowd dislike each other and are competing for power in the next election. And let's also remember that with the youth bulge in Iran and the fact that most of the population is quite secular, and some of them at least have full access to social media, they are learning things and certainly know that at least $55 billion is coming their way and are going to watch where that money goes. So I would predict that there will be changes inside Iran, hopefully in a better direction, certainly before whatever time period you're keeping expires on the nuclear deal.
So you think that in this period of time, of this 10 to 15 years, there can also be a chance for a regime change in Iran? Even that people here in Israel, Prime Minister and others, thinks that this deal cemented the Ayatollah's regime.
I think there could be regime change, but it would have to be bottom up in Iran, and I don't know whether there will be regime change. I don't think we can count on it. I hope there'll be regime change soon in Syria also. But I think the U.S. has learned a tough lesson that forcing it from outside is not a good strategy. And hopefully from inside, things will change. And if all these economic woes are there in Iran now, and the low price of oil is making things worse, there will have to be some loosening up of the reins inside Iran in order for people to get, it seems to me, for people who will demand more to get some and to keep any possible inside rebellion from happening if I were a leader of Iran. So all I'm saying is there could be changes in Iran in the next years. There could be changes in Israel in the next years, and there surely are changes in the region in the next years. So what have we been talking about here? A realignment of countries, the number of failing states. One of the pieces of good news for Israel is, as Dory Gold said, quietly, you have new and warm relations with the Sunni states. That's good news. That's something to think carefully about and to use as another form of insurance policy. So I just say that you can see it all as a negative horror, or you can see it as a possible, I'm not saying likely, a possible game changer.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Amajor, do you think that after watching the United States backing away from any forceful confrontation, there are forces in Iran that will look and will see this deal as an opportunity for a regime change? Or maybe they will say, you know, the West was not been willing to confront the Iranian extremist forces on the nuclear issue. Why should they confront it on other issues like the conventional war, human rights, gay rights, or other issues that bother us all?
I think that no one in the Middle East believes that the Americans are ready for a military confrontation with Iran. I'm not speaking about something very extreme, if tomorrow morning the Iranians will come with a bomb on the table. But other than that, the notion in the Middle East is very clear. United States of America is not ready for any real military confrontation. I'm not saying about sending airplanes here and there and some special forces to lead them to the targets. And that was understood by the Iranians, and this is why the Iranians were so strong in the negotiations, because they understood that not all the options are on the table, practically. And that was one of the issues which led at the end to the agreement, which I think is not satisfactory. I don't think that all of that is connected to regime change in Iran. That will be determined inside Iran by the strength of the opposition forces in one side and the readiness of the Iranians' regime to take all the measures which are necessary to stop the opposition, if opposition will emerge in the future. The agreement itself does not change the balance within the forces in Iran. What might lead to change in the future is economic pressure that I don't see it coming again, and problems inside the Iranian system. But if I can judge from what I saw in 2009 and what I see today, and the agreement which was agreed by the leader of Iran, I think that they feel that they can contain any real opposition to the system. Within the system, they can agree about arguments and even elections, and even maybe someone will be elected, although they have some other preference. But at the end of the day, the present regime feels that he can contain any attempt to change the system by any strong opposition.
But Mr. Amiel, maybe that was the problem of Israeli policy. You were being perceived by the actors and the president himself as a single-mind tract that only think that force will solve the problem. And you still think that only with force or bombing Iran will solve the problem. And the president saying, this will not solve the problem. Let's look at other options. And that maybe was the creator of the crisis between the Obama administration and the Prime Minister Netanyahu government.
No, mistake number two. I never said,
only two?
I never said, and I hear okay. Some to testify, I never said that military option is better than a good agreement. Never. I thought all the time, and I still believe, that a good agreement is better than the military option. The truth of the matter is that you cannot reach a good agreement if the other side understands, yet you don't have a military option. And when the Iranians understood that there is no real military options on the table, almost by definition, the agreement cannot be a good one. So I never said that a good agreement is not much better than any good military option. And I said it again and again during all our conversations, and I still believe that that was the case, but at the same time, the fact that it was understood, it doesn't matter how and where, that the Americans are not serious about the military option, the agreement is not the one that I hoped for would be reached by the Americans.
Thank you, Mr. Eisenberg. How do you think you could act, France and others, the allies, in a way that the Iranian will understand that after this deal, you will not bear other behavior of Iran, like funding Hezbollah, like their attempt to get an hegemonic regime in the region, the fact that they try to get into Syria, keep on the Shiite revolution.
Here. 2 points here. The first one is that there is general agreement amongst the P5, not simply the Western powers, by the way, also Russia and China. And Russia, as you know, is quite important in the region. There is agreement that there should be no further nuclear proliferation in the region. And that will, I think, remain true for the foreseeable future. There you will have agreement. You will have no agreement between the same group of countries on specific behavior by Iran here or there. Look at the respective positions of the members of the P5 in the region, notably in Syria. There will be no agreement on this. And what makes it easier not to agree is precisely that you are in a non-nuclear situation. Second point, the notion of regime change. I would obviously be delighted if tomorrow we had a regime change in Iran with the Islamic Republic out. Would this mean that Iran would become a shrinking violet? That Iran would become a satisfied power? That it would not feel entitled to exercise economic, political, and strategic hegemony in the region? Well, maybe, but if people thought that once Mao Zedong left the scene and that China would grow into an economic superpower, that therefore China would become a soft, cuddly kitten which would do America's will in the world, these people were slightly disappointed, and I would venture to say that China is a much bigger security problem today than when it was a small, shitty communist power. Iran, as a well-developed capitalist society with a strong polity, reinforced by its democratic nature, may well be a very difficult partner for the incompetent Sunni states, which in Israel, for some bizarre reason, are usually referred to as the moderate Sunni monarchies.
So should we keep Iran as a dictatorship,
no,
Islamic?
No, I'm simply saying that for those of you who think that regime change would dispel any problems, notably after the JCPOA runs out, I think those people should be much more careful. I'm with Amos Yadlin on this one. Israel has to think about the very short period of time between now and the end of the JCPOA. It's a short period. You know, how long did it take India to move from nuclear recess deterrence in 1974 to military status in 1998? It took 24 years. Mm-hmm. Iran, I think we're okay for 15 years, but afterwards, who knows? And the fact that there will or will not have been regime change may not actually be of the essence. I'm not sure that that will be the game changer.
Sir John Jenkins, the Obama administration keeps saying that the nuclear ban is not for 10 years, not for 15 years, it's forever. Do you believe that?
I think, honestly, it's impossible to say at the moment. I mean, 15 years, I mean, Francois is right, in terms of actually, if Iran had intent, and they have strategic patience, I think one of the other things that Francois said is absolutely right. Iran is in Middle Eastern terms, is a formidable state in a way that its competitors are not. And Francois is also right in saying that this quest for hegemony and satisfaction predates the Islamic Republic. Look at the way the Shah behaved in the 1970s. And the state has become more formidable since then. I don't know what's going to happen inside Iran, and this is the fundamental problem. None of us know this. What we do know is that this is a state which is prepared, whose principal objective is survival and replication. So when Khamenei goes, those around him will seek to replicate the Islamic Republic, maybe with a more collective leadership, but in the same sort of form. If you look at opinion polling inside Iran, such opinion polling as there is, the majority of the population want a normalized state. They want better relations with the West, particularly the United States, and they want to live in the world as global citizens. If you look at the 97 elections, when maybe 70% of the IRGC voted for Khatami, since then, the regime took notice. So what they did was to remove those people they thought were most unsympathetic to them within the Revolutionary Guard, re-indoctrinate the Revolutionary Guard, and they're now sitting on top of basically a gendarmerie which protects their position against their own society, the besieged and the Revolutionary Guard. This is significant. I don't think there's... So you're asking questions about where the regime is going. I don't think... Regime change in Iran seems to me improbable. But I don't know how the regime will evolve over the next 15 years.
So what should be the strategy in this period of time, of this 10 to 15 years of the West and of Israel and United States to make the most chances that Iran will not get the facilities or the the notion that they can go into the bomb the day after?
Well, I think you need a cordon sanitaire of some sort around Iran. I think you need to do something about those states which Iran has helped to hollow out. I think principally Iraq at the moment, because I think Iraq is probably over the medium term stabilizable. Syria, I don't know. Yemen as well, we need a solution in Yemen. I mean, basically this is a form of collective security. Can collective security guarantee that Iran after 15 years will not pursue the nuclear option? No. I mean, Iran has the knowledge to do this now. And that they know how to do centrifuges, they know the fuel cycle, they know all this sort of stuff. That's not going to go away, and they can use the next 15 years if they wanted to pursue research on these issues. It's a question of the costs of the choices that Iran makes over the next 15 years and beyond 15 years. So, and those costs are not all related to a nuclear program. They're related to the other things that Iran does in the region. Mm-hmm. And that's a question of collective security.
Avner, in a lot of areas here, I heard this morning Yossi Bailing call the American administration and Kerry to go back to the roadmap. And maybe this is the right choice also with Iran, to create a roadmap of other issues in the region, like the democracy, like human rights, like relations with its neighbor, like the oil, like natural gas, like terror. And then to go in all those areas simultaneously and to show that this is not only one specific deal about the nuclear, but this is an overall thinking of how the Middle East will look like in the next decade to come.
It would be a great approach, but as we see from this panel, there is a separation between the nuclear area and the non-nuclear one. Now, in our side agreement, this is exactly the approach we embrace. But we need to understand right now we are going to have a battle over legitimacy. Using General Yadlin's analogies from yesterday, Iran will try to be Norway, to be back, to be admitted to the international community as a legitimate, not only legitimate, a state, but a legitimate power, regional power in the Middle East. If this happens, it will be very difficult to restrain Iran 10 and 15 years from now on nuclear issues and non-nuclear issues. So we cannot separate between the areas. Now, we need to make sure that Iran, as long as it continues to kill people in Syria, to support terrorism, and to test missiles in light of UN Security Council resolutions, we need to make sure Iran is North Korea, and it should be isolated, and then it will be much more, much easier to face or to cope with nuclear as well as non-nuclear issues.
Well, it didn't work with North Korea in such a success. Yeah,
well, I think that's a mistake, unless Iran earns it. There is another way to go. I think Iran's behavior since the deal with respect to proxy groups is negative. I think the fact that that on a parallel track we were able to negotiate the release of four people, and that although it was ugly, the sailors were freed, is more on the positive side of the ledger. But we all have to watch carefully. The deal, the sort of shorthand for the deal is mistrust and verify. And if all of the bells and whistles in the deal are observed, Iran will not have will have a longer breakout problem, but also will not have a nuclear weapon at least for 15 years and maybe forever, given the IAEA monitoring. I wanted to introduce something else, though. This is a dangerous neighborhood, and there's a nuclear power nearby named Pakistan that I would say could be a worse problem for this region in the short term, in nuclear terms, than Iran. If either a dirty bomb or a tactical nuke gets out of Pakistan into the hands of ISIS or some other group, and certainly there are some sympathizers in Pakistan of not just ISIS, I think we should keep some focus on that, because that could be, in the short term, much more of a threat to Israel's security and to the regional security than an Iranian bomb.
All right, we need to end this session in 3 minutes, so I want every one of you a really short comment. Do you think that the Iranian can draw the conclusion from what happened in this negotiation that they are part of the solution in the Middle East and not part of the problem? And should Israel act to change this formula? Mr. Amidror.
It's not a question. It's clear to everyone that the Iranians think that they are part of the solution, and many in the world think that it is part of the solution mistakenly. But this is not a problem of Israel. Israel should prepare itself to a situation in which we will have to deal with Iran, which is going nuclear, without having to trust anyone who will do the job for us. And this is a huge burden, not easy one, but we should take it, otherwise we might find ourselves in a strategic surprise which will not, which would be very bad for Israel.
Mr. Eisenberg?
Israel is all too well placed to know that the Middle East is a region in which you do not produce solutions. It is a region which produces problems. And Iran is part of the problem set. I have used in the INSS setting the expression of the Middle East entering into a 30 years war. I think that is pretty much the case. Strategic agility,
Counting from when? So we'll never counting from.
I would count from the breaking out of Daesh in the summer of 2014. So you're at the beginning.
Another 28.
You're pretty much at the beginning of this cycle, when you have religion, territory, and power simultaneously in play. That is what makes the 30 years war in Europe different from other historical episodes. That is what you now have in the Middle East, which you didn't used to have. Well, in this situation, friendship with the United States, strong strategic relationship, those countries in Europe which are able and willing to support that, and for the rest, strategic opportunism is the only way you're going to be able to cope.
Sir John Jenkins.
I don't think there's one solution. I don't think there's one problem in the Middle East. I don't think there's one solution. I'm not sure there are any solutions, really, to all this stuff. But I think when we deal with the problems in the Middle East, we need to be clear, absolutely clear, what problem it is we're dealing with at any given time. What the Iranians want to do is to make this a package. And I think that's what we want to, that is exactly what we need to avoid.
Avner.
So as I see it, Iran is a problem maker. As long as you have Iran, you have problems. So I cannot see how it will be part of a long-term solution, a sustainable one. I think the solution from the Israeli point of view is in a joint campaign, with well-coordinated with America, the things that we didn't have until now, and we should work from tomorrow and maybe with the next administration to have it in the next decade or so.
Ms. Jennerman, I will ask you the last words to that
this
panel.
This administration soon will sign a long-term MOU with Israel, will continue to provide it with a qualitative edge, and will never abandon Israel. And the policy of the United States is to prevent, not contain, but prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. And I predict that if there is a change of circumstances here and Iran violates the deal and the snapback doesn't work, that the U.S. will be prepared as a last option to use the military option.
And with that optimistic note, I will end this panel. Thank you very much for being here.